Welcome to Fayetteville Community Church. We welcome our church family and our visiting friends. Thank you for coming to worship with us. To find out more about our church, upcoming events, and other church activities, you may visit us online at www.fccnc.us.
Baptism does not save you. Rather, those who are saved get baptized. Amen. Now, baptize is a Greek word transliterated into letters of the English alphabet. When they were doing the 1611 King James Bible, they could not come up with an English word for baptize, and so they took the Greek word for baptized, or the Latin word for baptized, and they did what they call transliterated it. It's a translation rather than they did it exactly from the letters of the alphabet. By far the most best known and most influential of all English translations of the Bible is the King James Version. Now, I use the King James Version mostly in my study and when I do a lesson, but I use a lot of other translations to get the meanings to where that I feel like that they are right. Through the King James Version, the word baptized has been carried over into the majority of all subsequent English versions of the Bible. The simple root form of the Greek word bapto was translated into English, and it means to dip. The Greek bapto means to dip something into a fluid and then take it out again. Strong's gives the following as the primary meaning of the verb bapto when it says to cover wholly with fluid or to dip. Rick Renner, in his book, Sparkling Gems, which I have a copy right here, his lesson on baptism, he calls to dip and die. And so this afternoon, I went home and I boiled some eggs. And this is the way they looked when I got them boiled. But then I decided I would do the Easter thing, and I would do this to them. So these color eggs were dipped into a fluid that was blue or green or red. And when you dip them into that fluid, it completely covered over that egg. And that's what the word baptism means, is to dip into a fluid and you come out different. Amen. Baptized, in other words, means to cause something to be dipped. Now, what we're doing in these lessons is we are following along out of Hebrews 6, verses 1 and 2. Verse 1 says, therefore, leaving the principles, this is not on your page, of the doctrine of Christ, let us go on into perfection or into maturity, not laying again the foundation of repentance from dead works and of faith toward God, or the doctrine of baptisms. So we've already covered those three things. And then of laying on of hands, and of the resurrection of the dead, and of eternal judgment. Those are basic doctrines of the Christian faith. And that's what we are teaching here right now, is not necessarily doctrines of our church, but doctrines of the Christian faith. Now, we observe the word baptisms in this verse, which is plural, not singular. This indicates plainly that the complete doctrine of the Christian faith included more than one type of baptism. Number one, the baptism was preached and practiced by John the Baptist, a baptism in water. But it is directly connected with the message and the experience of repentance. Mark 1:4 says, John came baptizing in the wilderness and preaching a baptism of repentance for the remission of sins. Then number two, there's a baptism that is not precisely described by any one word in the New Testament, but which we call the baptism of suffering. Luke 12, verse 50, Jesus says, "But I have a baptism to be baptized with, and how distressed I am until it is accomplished." The Living Bible says that there is a terrible baptism ahead of me, and how I am pent up until it is accomplished. So you see, there's things that Jesus, that he held inside of him, and he knew what he was going to have to go through with. In Mark chapter 10, verse 38, John came and James came, and he requested, they were the sons of Zebedee, they were called the sons of thunder, and they came to Jesus, and they requested of him that when he came back in his kingdom, that one of them could sit on the right hand and the other on the left. And Jesus said back to them, "You do not know what you ask. Can you drink the cup that I drink and be baptized with the baptism that I am baptized with?" And eventually they both were baptized with the baptism of suffering. They both died a horrible death. Now Jesus here refers to the spiritual and physical surrender that lay ahead of him as he trod the path to the cross. The surrender of his whole being, spirit, soul, and body, to the appointed will of the Father, that he might take upon himself the guilt of the world's sin, and then pay by his vicarious sufferings for the price that was required to expiate the sin. Now Jesus went and he carried all of our sins upon himself. By these words, Jesus indicated to his disciples that the fulfillment of his plan for their lives would be in due course demand of them a surrender of their whole being into the hands of God, even if need be, the suffering of death. Now, the third baptism that we are looking at tonight is the Christian New Testament baptism in the water. Matthew 28:19, this is the commission from Jesus. "Go therefore and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit." The primary feature that thus distinguishes Christian baptism from the baptism of John the Baptist is that Christian baptism is to be carried out in the full name and authority of the triune God, God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit. This was not done with John's baptism. And now the next baptism we come to is the baptism in the Holy Spirit. Acts verse 1, verse 5 says, "For John truly baptized with water, but you shall be baptized with the Holy Spirit not many days from now." Jesus also reveals the basic purpose of the baptism in the Holy Spirit in Acts 1:8. As he's getting ready to go back to heaven, he says to all the people that are gathered there on the mountaintop, he says, "But you shall receive power when the Holy Spirit has come upon you, and you shall be witnesses to me both in Jerusalem and in all Judea and in Samaria and unto the uttermost part of the earth." Primarily, therefore, the baptism in the Holy Spirit is being endued with power from on high to be a witness for Jesus Christ. Amen. Now, there are conditions to be met. The first two baptisms, John baptism and the baptism of suffering, we are not going to go into detail anymore tonight about them, but we're going to look at Christian baptism and the baptism in the Holy Spirit. In Acts 2, verses 37 and 38, "Now when they heard this, they were cut to the heart." This is on the day of Pentecost. "And they said to Peter and the other apostles, 'Men and brethren, what shall we do?' Then Peter said to them, 'Repent and let every one of you be baptized in the name of Jesus Christ for the remission of sins, and you shall receive the gift of the Holy Spirit.'" So the first thing that they had to do was to repent, and then they could be baptized in water. We have seen that repentance, which Miss Vivian covered greatly last week, repentance is the first response that God requires from any sinner who desires to be saved. Repentance must precede baptism. Baptism is the outward seal of or affirmation of the inward change that has been produced by repentance. Christ states that everywhere the gospel is preached, those who desire to be saved are required to do two things: repent and believe and be baptized. The New Testament church took him at his word. Once a person had believed in Jesus for salvation, he was then immediately baptized. Again in Mark 16, 15 and 16, the commission, he said, "Go ye into all the world and preach the gospel to every creature. He that believeth and is baptized shall be saved." So you see, belief and baptism go together. "But he that believeth not shall be damned." Now in Acts chapter 16, verses 25 through 34, at midnight, Paul is in prison with his old buddy Silas, and the whole prison is shaken at midnight by a supernatural earthquake, and all the doors of the prison were opened. The jailer, knowing that he would have to answer with his own life for any prisoners who might escape, prepared to commit suicide. But Paul restrained him by saying, "Do yourself no harm, for we are all still here." Under deep conviction, the jailer then asked, "Sirs, what must I do to be saved?" So you see, Paul and Silas had been singing and praising the Lord, and the jailer had heard it, but then the earthquake comes, and he wants to know if Paul and Silas are saved, then he wants part of that. And so they said to him, "Believe on the Lord Jesus Christ, and you will be saved, and your what? Household." Your household. I love the places in the Bible where it promises things not just to us, but our household. So when we see our kids doing things as they are little or as they grow, we see them do things, but you keep confessing that word. The word says that my household belongs to the Lord, and I'm claiming them children for the Lord. I'm claiming that somebody's going to cross their path and that they're going to be saved. And I know people that their parents prayed for them and prayed for them, and their parents died, but their kids came to the Lord. So the prayers go on after we leave this world. Amen. Now, Paul and Silas, they then presented the gospel message to the whole household. They included in this message the requirement of baptism. And responding with faith, the whole household was immediately baptized in water. They didn't even wait for dawn to come. How would you like to be taken to some pond in the middle of the night and dunked in cold water? You know, that's what these people were doing. The response of the jailer and his family is the standard pattern in the New Testament. Baptism was regarded as an urgent requirement. It was not just do it if you want to. It is included in the verse that you believe and you get baptized. Okay? But it was always preceded by faith. The first two requirements that we said for baptism is repenting and believing. And they line up with the first three foundational doctrines that we see presented in Hebrews 6, verses 1 and 2, repentance, faith, and the doctrine of baptisms. Baptism must be built upon believing, repenting, and believing. Now, there's several other scriptures of water baptism in the New Testament. Matthew 28, verses 18 through 20 is Jesus' commission. Acts 2, verse 41, on the day of Pentecost, they that gladly received his word were baptized, and that would have been about 3,000 people. That's a pretty big baptism, right? Wesley, how would you like to do that one Sunday morning? Yeah. In Acts 8, 12, Philip at Samaria, the Bible says they were baptized, both men and women. So you see, it's not just for men and it's not just for women. It's for everyone, but it has to be somebody that can repent and believe. That's why we do not do child baptism, because a baby that you sprinkle water on does not repent, and they do not believe. So that's why we do not believe in child baptism. Amen? And then in Acts chapter 9, verse 18, Paul was baptized by Ananias, who came, and when Paul was baptized, what happened to him? He had been blind for 3 days, and when he was baptized, he got his sight back. Amen? And then at Cornelius' house, where Peter went down, they received in Cornelius' house the Holy Spirit before they were baptized. And so God does not have to be put in a box and everything done the same way all the time. What happens to you is not necessarily what happens to someone else, right? And Acts 16, verses 14 and 15, there was a lady named Lydia. And she and her friends, they met by a riverside. A lot of people in the Bible, they had their meetings. If there was not a temple in town, they met by the riverside. And so they were out by the riverside, and Paul preaches to them. And then they want to be baptized, so he baptizes them in the river. Water baptism shows that we have crucified the old man, and through God's grace, we are dead to sin. Romans 6, verses 6 and 7 says, knowing this, that our old man was crucified with him, with Christ, that the body of sin might be done away with, that we should no longer be slaves of sin. For he who has died has been freed or justified from sin. Romans 6, verses 11, 12, and 14 says, likewise, you also reckon yourselves to be dead indeed to sin, but alive to God in Christ Jesus our Lord. Therefore, do not let sin reign in your mortal body, that you should obey it in its lust. For sin shall not have dominion over you, for you are not under law, but under grace. When you receive Jesus Christ as your Savior and you are baptized in water, sin should not have dominion over you any longer. That means that you don't willingly sin. Amen? You strive to live like Jesus Christ. As Christians, we are to reckon ourselves as dead to sin through the grace of God in Jesus Christ. There is no reason why sin should continue to exercise any control or dominion over us. The ordinance by which we carry out this burial is the ordinance of Christian baptism. In every service of Christian baptism, there are two successive stages. First, there is a burial into a grave of water. And then there is a resurrection where you come out of that grave into a new life that is lived to God and righteousness. God's Spirit, as we go along, alone can give the baptized believer the power that he needs for this new life of righteousness. And now we're going on to the baptism in the Holy Spirit. How many of you in here came from a major Protestant denomination? That means Baptist, Methodist, Presbyterian, any major denomination. How many of you came from a Pentecostal background? Okay, how many of you came from a Catholic background? Okay, I'm going to give you a few verses. I know that I grew up in a Baptist church, and we were never taught that there was the baptism in the Holy Spirit. Now, we knew by reading the Bible, especially in the book of Acts, that there it was mentioned, but there was never any emphasis put upon it. So, first of all, if you came from a major Protestant denomination, you probably received no teaching on the baptism in the Holy Spirit. But, in fact, a lot of them taught against it. But what we're going to cover is what the Word of God says. How many of you know that the Word stands when nothing else stands? And in the Bible, it even says these verses right here, that we can make the Word of God of none effect by our traditions. So we have to learn to turn loose to our traditions and believe what the Word says. And believe it like it says it. In Matthew chapter 15, 6b, it says, "Thus have you made the commandment of God of none effect by your tradition." That means that you can do away with the Word of God just by your tradition if you don't accept what it says. And then Mark 7, 13a, it says, "Making the Word of God of none effect through your tradition." The NIV says, "You nullify the Word of God by traditions that you have had handed down." So sometimes we have to turn loose of what has been handed down and accept what the Word of God says. And then 1 Corinthians 1:17, the Apostle Paul said, "For Christ sent me not to baptize, but to preach the gospel, not with the wisdom of words, lest the cross of Christ should be made of none effect." And the NIV says that the Word of God should be emptied of its power. That tradition can make the Word of God emptied of its power. We do not want a powerless gospel. Amen. Amen. Galatians 5 verse 4 says, "Christ is become of no effect unto you. Whosoever of you are justified by the law, you are fallen from grace." Now, since the turn of the 20th century, the subject of the baptism in the Holy Spirit has been arousing keen interest and discussion among ever-widening circles of the Christian church. Along about 1900, there came a revival in California that swept across the land. And God has revivals in every generation. Amen? Every generation of children are given the Word of God, especially in our day and time. And today it continues to be a theme of study, of discussion, and even controversy in the Christian circles. We will seek to approach the study in a way that is careful, thorough, and scriptural. Now, I fully believe that in Joel 2, verses 28 and 29, it says, "In the last days that God would pour His Spirit out upon all flesh." How many of you agree that we are in the last of the last days? Amen. The last days began on the day of Pentecost. So, folks, we're already over 2,000 years in the last days. And so I've heard some preachers say that we are in what is called the toenails of time, that we are through the feet and we're out to the toenail, and that's how close we are to the end of time, is to the toenails of time. Now, I'm going to show you seven New Testament references to the baptism in the Holy Spirit. We don't want to give you anything that is not in the Word of God. First, we shall enumerate the passages in the New Testament where the word baptize is used in connection with the Holy Spirit. Appropriately enough, since seven is distinctively the number of the Holy Spirit, there are seven such passages. John the Baptist contrasted his own ministry with the ministry of Christ, which was to follow. And he said, "I indeed baptize you with water unto or into repentance. But he who is coming after me is mightier than I, whose sandals I am not worthy to carry. He will baptize you with or in the Holy Spirit and fire." Although the New King James Version uses the English preposition with in conjunction with the verb phrase to baptize, the actual preposition that was used in the original Greek is in. In the Bible where it says with, it should have been translated in. The preposition in is according to the Greek in every instance. Mark chapter 1 and verse 8. He says, "I indeed baptized you with water, but he will baptize you with or in the Holy Spirit." Luke 3:16, the words of John the Baptist. John answered, saying to them all, I indeed baptize you with water, but one mightier than I is coming, whose sandal strap I am not worthy to loose. He will baptize you with or in the Holy Spirit and with fire. And then in John 1, verse 33, this is the testimony of John concerning Christ. He said, I did not know him, but he who sent me to baptize with water said to me, upon whom you see the Spirit descending and remaining on him, this is he who baptizes you with or in the Holy Spirit. John knew that Jesus was coming along and that his baptism was not sufficient, but that there was going to be a baptism in the Holy Spirit. And then before Jesus' ascension into heaven, he said to his disciples in Acts 1:5, for John truly baptized with water, but you shall be baptized with or in the Holy Spirit not many days from now. More literally, Jesus says, you shall be baptized in the Holy Spirit. In Acts 11, verse 16, Peter is describing the events that took place in the household of Cornelius. And in this connection, he quotes exactly the words of Jesus that were in Acts chapter 1, verse 5. He says, then I remembered the word of the Lord, how he said, John indeed baptized with water, but you shall be baptized with or in the Holy Spirit. In 1 Corinthians 12, verse 13, Paul says, for by one Spirit we were all baptized into one body, whether Jews or Greeks, whether slaves or free, and we have all been made to drink into one Spirit. There is only one Holy Spirit. Yeah. There's one Father, there's one Son, there's one Holy Spirit. So this is what he is saying. The New King James Version uses the preposition by one Spirit we were all baptized into one body. But the preposition that is used in the original Greek text is in one Spirit we were all baptized into one body. The whole teaching of the entire New Testament agrees on this fact, clearly and emphatically stated, Jesus Christ alone and no other is the one who baptizes in the Holy Spirit. Now, the baptism in the Holy Spirit does not make a person a member of the body of Christ. Rather, it is a supernatural seal acknowledging that that person has already, by faith, become a member of Christ's body. How did you get into Christ's body? By believing and being baptized in water. Paul used the phrase, we have all been made to drink into one Spirit. In modern English, we would say, we have all been given to drink of one Spirit. The use of the verb to drink agrees with what Jesus himself says concerning the Holy Spirit. Now, I want to show you something that Jesus did in John chapter 7 and verses 37 through 39. Jesus always kept the seven feasts that were set out for the Israelite nation to keep. The feasts that have already been fulfilled, and Jesus fulfilled them in his first coming, were the Feast of Unleavened Bread and Passover that he did the week and the night that he was crucified. And then he came forth on the feast when he was resurrected. He came forth on the Feast of First Fruits. And then when he went back to heaven, he sent the Holy Spirit on the day of Pentecost. So he fulfilled in his first coming the four feasts of Israel. And you say, well, that doesn't have any meaning to us. But yes, it does. Everything that happens with Christ has something to do with one of those feasts. That he's got three more feasts that will be fulfilled when he comes the second time. When he comes with the Feast of Trumpets and then the Day of Atonement and the Feast of Tabernacles. We got a lot to look forward to, folks. in the Lord, there it is not boring to be living a Christian life, because we have a lot to look forward to. There's a lot more in front of us than there is behind us. And I just want to give you a little background of this right here. If you read it, Jesus, you remember in the Bible when a man came to him and he was blind, and Jesus spit and made a paste for his eyes. And then he put that paste upon that man's eyes, and he didn't say, be healed. He told the man, he said, you go down to the pool of Siloam, and you dip yourself down in that pool and wash your eyes and receive your sight. So Jesus left something undone that the man had to do for himself. Now, these verses right here in John chapter 7, verses 37 through 39, the Feast of Tabernacles is happening in the city of Jerusalem. And as I said, Jesus always went to these feasts. But in the first part of this chapter, he tells his buddies to go on to Jerusalem because they're looking for him to kill him. And so he says, I'll come on later. And so he comes on later, and he starts ministering to people there at the Feast of Tabernacles. And so it comes this last day of the Feast of Tabernacles, which was the eighth day, and that was a day when the people, the ones that were the priests, they had gone to the pool of Siloam, and they had dipped water out of the pool of Siloam, and they brought that water back, and they had it in like cauldrons on the side of the temple. And if on the day of the eighth day, it was a tradition that they would pour that water out from the pool of Siloam, and anybody that could get in that water while it was coming out could be healed. And so when that happened, those priests came forth. They poured out that water into the place, and the people were dancing and praising the Lord. You know, the Israelis can really praise the Lord, right, Wesley? They can sing and dance and do all the stuff. And so they were doing this. And so Jesus gets up, and the Bible says, Jesus stood, and he cried out, saying, if anyone thirst, let him come to me and drink. Let him come to me and drink. He who believes in me, as the scripture has said, out of his heart shall flow rivers of living water. But this he spoke concerning the Spirit, whom those believing in him would receive, for the Holy Spirit was not yet given, because Jesus was not yet glorified. And what Jesus was referring to was back in the book of Isaiah. It says, therefore with joy shall you draw water out of the wells of salvation, and then you will say, praise the Lord, when this water begins to bubble up inside of you. This in turn harmonizes with the passage in Acts chapter 2 verse 4 concerning the disciples in the upper room on the day of Pentecost, where it states that they were all filled with the Holy Spirit. And they were all filled with the Holy Spirit and began to speak with other tongues as the Spirit gave them utterance. And this agrees with various passages in the book of Acts that speak about believers receiving the Holy Spirit. For example, when the Samaritans were converted through the preaching of Philip, we read that Peter and John were later sent down to them from Jerusalem. And it says in Acts chapter 8, verses 15 and 17, who, when they had come down, prayed for them that they might receive the Holy Spirit. Then they laid hands on them, and they received what? The Holy Spirit. Peter says concerning the people in the house of Cornelius, upon whom the Holy Spirit had just fallen, in Acts 10:47, can anyone forbid these people be baptized in water, that these should not be baptized who have received the Holy Spirit just as we have? And then Paul asked the disciples when he meets them at Ephesus, he said, did you receive of the Holy Spirit when you believed? In all these phrases, the use is to drink of the Holy Spirit, to be filled with the Holy Spirit, to receive the Holy Spirit, suggests that there is an experience in which the believer receives the fullness of the Holy Spirit inwardly within himself. And now we're going to look at immersion from above. We have seen that the literal root meaning of the verb phrase to baptize is to cause something to be dipped or immersed. The phrase to be baptized in the Holy Spirit suggests that the believer's whole personality is immersed, surrounded, and enveloped in the presence and power of the Holy Spirit come down over him from above and from without, right? Sounds like it comes from above. We need to bear in mind that in the natural order, there are two possible ways of being immersed in water. A person may go down beneath the surface of the water and come up from underneath it. Or a person may walk under a waterfall and allow himself to be what? Immersed from above. And this second form of immersion is the spiritual counterpart of the baptism of the Holy Spirit. Without exception, in every place in the book of Acts where the baptism in the Holy Spirit is described, language is used that indicates that the Holy Spirit comes down over or is poured out upon the believer from above. For example, on the day of Pentecost in Acts chapter 2, verse 2, there came a sound from heaven as of a rushing wind, and it filled the whole house where they were sitting. These words reveal that the Holy Spirit came down over these disciples from above and completely immersed and enveloped them, even to the extent of filling the whole house where they were sitting. Yeah. And later, Peter twice confirms this interpretation of the experience. First, he declares that this experience is the fulfillment of God's promise. In Acts chapter 2, verse 17, he says, and quoting from Joel 2, verses 28, he says, "And it shall come to pass in the last days, says God, that I will pour out of my spirit on all flesh." Yeah. All right, pinch yourself. What are you? Flesh. So are you eligible for the pouring out of the Spirit? If that's the only requirement that you have is that you repent and be baptized in water and be part of the family of God and you be flesh. And he says you shall, And your sons and your daughters shall prophesy. Your young men shall see visions and your old men, the correct translation for old men really is your mature saints shall dream dreams. And then he says in Acts 2 verse 33, "Therefore, being exalted to the right hand of God," Jesus being exalted to the right hand of God, "and having received from the Father the promise of the Holy Spirit," the Father had promised Jesus that when he came back to heaven, that he would not leave us comfortless, yeah, that he would not leave us alone, but that he would send the Holy Spirit. And Peter says, what you see right now is the fulfillment of what you heard Jesus say. In each case, the picture is one of the Holy Spirit being poured out over the believers from above. In Acts chapter 8, verse 16, the phrase used for the same experience is that of the Holy Spirit falling upon the believers. Here again, the language depicts the Spirit coming down over them from above. For as yet, Acts 8, 16, he had fallen on none of them. They had only been baptized in the name of the Lord Jesus. In the early church, the disciples made sure that people that received Jesus, they repented and were baptized in water, that they received the Holy Spirit. Amen. In Acts chapter 10, concerning the people in the house of Cornelius, and Cornelius was a Gentile, both phrases are used one after the other. In verse 44, we read, "The Holy Spirit fell upon all those who heard the word." In verse 45, we read, "The gift of the Holy Spirit had been poured out on the Gentiles also." Everybody say, hallelujah. Hallelujah. I doubt if there's a Jew in here. We're all Gentiles, amen? And so the Holy Spirit has come to us as it came to the Jews. This shows that the phrases to fall upon and to be poured out on are used interchangeably in this connection. Again, when Peter describes the same event when he's telling some of the other people about what happened, he says the Holy Spirit fell upon them as it did on us at the beginning. Here the phrase, as upon us at the beginning, indicates that the experience of Cornelius and his household was exactly parallel to the experience of the disciples in the upper room on the day of Pentecost. And then over in Ephesus, after they had been baptized in water, it says, and when Paul had laid hands on them, the Holy Spirit came upon them. Here the phrase come upon is obviously similar in meaning to the phrase that has been used in our previous passages to fall upon. The experience of which we are speaking is made up of two distinct but complementary aspects. One is outward and the other inward. Outwardly, the invisible presence and power of the Holy Spirit comes down from above upon the believer and surrounds, envelops, and immerses him. But inwardly, the believer, in the likeness of one drinking, receives the presence and power of the Holy Spirit within himself until there comes a point at which the Holy Spirit, thus received, turns into a well that is coming up from inside, from within the believer, and it flows like a river from the inmost depth of his being. No human language can fully describe a mighty supernatural experience such as this, but it may perhaps be illuminating to borrow a picture from the Old Testament. In the days of Noah, the whole world was submerged beneath the flood. In bringing about the flood, God used two distinct but complementary processes. In Genesis 7:11, it says, in the 600th year of Noah's life, in the second month, the 17th day of the month, on that day, all of the fountains of the great deep were broken up. In other words, all the water that was under the earth, it could rain 40 days and 40 nights, which it has practically here this summer, and we would not be flooded. But what happened in the flood is the inside of the earth had water, and it came up from there, and then it says the windows of heaven were opened. I'll give you just a little bit of something. Before the flood, it never rained. It never rained. The earth was filled from below with the dew. And as people looked up in the sky, there was water between us and the sun. The earth was covered with water all the way around. And so when people looked up in the sky, they did not see Carolina blue. The sky was the color of the rainbow, because the sun was shining through the water that covered the earth. This kept people from being sunburned. The earth was different. But on this day, the water came up from the bottom and the stuff from above came down and it flooded the earth. We have no idea what the earth looked like before the flood. So that's why when they went out after they got out of the ark and they looked up, God put a rainbow in the sky so they could see what they had seen before they were put on that ark. Ain't God good? Amen. I went to SeaWorld, and the girl there, she told me that we never did have to worry about sharks becoming extinct because the fish in the seas were not destroyed. So they've had 6,000 years to be in the ocean and only 4,000 years to be on the earth. So there's more sharks. She said there's four sharks for every person that lives on this earth. but I don't want mine. You can have it. Okay. This account reveals that the waters of the flood came from two sources from above or from within. The fountains of the great deep were broken up, and the windows of heaven were opened, and the rain was poured down. The flood of Noah's day was a flood of divine wrath and judgment. But the flood that immerses the New Testament believer is one of divine mercy, glory, and blessing. Hallelujah. The New Testament believer who receives the fullness of the Holy Spirit exhibits the same two aspects as in the account of Noah's flood. From within, the fountains of the great deep within the believer's own personality are broken up, and there gushes out a mighty flood of blessing and power from his inmost being. But from above, the windows of God's mercy are opened upon the believer, and there is poured upon him such a deluge of glory and blessing that his whole personality is immersed in its outpouring. We're not speaking of two separate experiences, but rather of two distinct yet complementary aspects that together make up the fullness of one single experience. We have considered the invisible inward nature of the baptism in the Holy Spirit, but we must go on to consider the outward manifestations that accompany this inward experience. We must point out that it is perfectly scriptural to use the word manifestation in connection with the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit himself is by his very nature invisible. He is compared by Jesus to the wind. Jesus says concerning the operation of the Holy Spirit, "The wind blows where it wishes, and you hear the sound of it, but cannot tell where it comes from and where it goes. And so is everyone that is born of the Spirit." Although the wind itself is invisible, the effects that the wind produces when it blows can in many cases be both seen and heard. When the wind blows, the dust rises from the street, the trees bend in one direction, the leaves rustle, the waves of the sea roar, the clouds blow across the sky. These effects are produced by the wind, and they can be seen and heard. So it is, Jesus says, with the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit himself is invisible, but the effects the Holy Spirit produces when he begins to work can often be seen and heard. This fact is confirmed by the language of the New Testament in various places. Let us turn to Peter's description of the effects produced by the descent of the Holy Spirit on the day of Pentecost. "Therefore, being exalted at the right hand of God, and having received from the Father the promise of the Holy Spirit, he," Christ, "poured out this which you now do" what? "See and hear." The effects of the descent of the Holy Spirit could be both seen and heard. Paul describes the work of the Spirit in his own ministry in these words, "And my speech and my preaching were not with persuasive words of human wisdom, but they were in demonstration of the Spirit and of the power." He also says that the Spirit can have a similar effect in every believer's experience. The manifestation of the Spirit is given to each one for the profit of all. God does not give us bad gifts. Every good gift and every perfect gift cometh down from the Father of lights. Notice the phrases that Paul uses in connection with the Holy Spirit: the demonstration of the Spirit and the manifestation of the Spirit. These two words, demonstration and manifestation, show clearly that the presence and the operation of the Holy Spirit can produce effects that can be perceived by our physical senses. Let's turn to the various passages in the New Testament where the baptism in the Holy Spirit is described. That is where we are told what actually happened to the people who received this experience. And let's see what the outward manifestations are that accompany this operation of the Spirit. Three places in the New Testament we are told what happened when people were baptized in the Holy Spirit. The words are this: first, on the day of Pentecost, "And suddenly there came a sound from heaven as of a rushing mighty wind, and it filled the whole house where they were sitting, and there appeared to them divided tongues as a fire, and one sat upon each of them, and they were filled with the Holy Spirit." And everybody say, "And began to speak with other tongues as the Spirit gave them utterance. Second, we turn to the house of Cornelius, Acts 10, verses 44 and 46, through 46. While Peter was still speaking these words, the Holy Spirit fell upon all those who heard the word. And those of the circumcision, or those Jews that had come with Peter, who had believed, were astonished, as many as came with Peter, because the gift of the Holy Spirit had been poured out on the Gentiles in Cornelius' house. And let's read this together. For they heard them speak with tongues and magnify God. The third time in Ephesus, when Paul laid his hands on them, the Holy Spirit came upon them, and they spoke with tongues and prophesied. In comparing these three passages, we find one and only one outward manifestation that is common to all three of these occasions where people receive the baptism in the Holy Spirit. In each case, the Spirit explicitly states that those who received this experience spoke with tongues or spoke with other tongues. Now, if there's anything that you have kick about in receiving the Holy Spirit, it's because you speak in tongues. Well, let me give y'all a little something that happened. When there was the Tower of Babel, there were 3,000 people killed that day, and the tongue was changed. But before the Tower of Babel, they had all spoke the same language, but God confused their tongue that day. And then on the day of Pentecost, when he redeemed the tongue, everybody began to speak in a holy language, and he redeemed the tongue on the day of Pentecost. And so we received the Holy Spirit. If you ask somebody, I know when I was in 1972, when I was seeking the baptism in the Holy Spirit, I asked the people, do I have to speak in tongues? And I tell everybody now, no, but you get to. You get to. Brother Yutzi, where you at? Stand up. I want you to say praise the Lord and hallelujah in German. Loud.
Lieber Gott, ich bin jetzt hier bevor dir und ich sage das du mein.
Hallelujah. Okay, would you stand up and say praise the Lord, hallelujah in Spanish.
Gloria a Dios. Aleluya.
Now, does that make any of you nervous?
No.
Why? Because you know it's a language. Okay, the difference in that, them speaking in German and speaking in Spanish, is you don't have to sit in a classroom for 4 years to learn to speak the language of the Spirit. When you ask for the Lord to baptize you in the Holy Spirit. And don't get hung up on that, folks, because the Bible says you shall receive power after that the Holy Spirit has come upon you, and you will be witnesses. But never fear anything that God does for you, because he will never give you anything that is bad. Every good gift and every perfect gift. And on the day of Pentecost, I'm just going to give you just a little explanation. The 120, they were in the upper room, and the Holy Spirit came upon them. This was about 6 o'clock in the morning. And they all began to pray in a tongue as the Spirit gave them utterance. That's why they had gathered in the upper room. Jesus said, you stay in that upper room until I come to you. And when I come to you, I'm going to give you power from on high. And so they had been going to that upper room every day and night for 10 days. And on this particular night, they had been praying all night. And they had prayed so much that here come the Holy Ghost at 6 o'clock in the morning and joined them in prayer. And it sat upon each of them. That was at 6 in the morning. And then about 9 o'clock in the morning, the book of Acts says they went down into the streets to all the people that were gathered in the streets from all over the world. There were two miracles that day. Those people, those 120 that had been in the upper room, they came out of there full of the Holy Spirit and power, and they began to speak in tongues, and everybody that was there heard them speak in their own language. This was a bunch of unlearned people. It was not professors from universities that knew the languages. But the Bible says that they began to speak. A lady asked me the other day, she said, "Do you have to speak in tongues?" I said, "No, you get to. But if you never ask, you'll never receive. But because the Bible says, ask and you shall receive, seek and you shall find, and knock and it shall be opened unto you." And we will give you a chance in the future to receive the baptism in the Holy Spirit. Do it now. If you want to receive the Holy Spirit, now I'm going to tell you something. Out of your belly will flow rivers of living water. As you see the Apostle Paul, a lot of times it's easier for you to receive the Holy Spirit if there are people to lay hands on you. Because you see the power is in that socket right there. That socket right there has power coming to it. But if you stick a lamp cord in there, it'll light up a light because the power is manifested through the light. You see? So all of you that have received Jesus as your Savior are eligible for the baptism in the Holy Spirit. So if there are some of you here that want to receive the Holy Spirit but you don't want to do it tonight, I've got two little books that I'll loan you, but you got to promise me with blood that you'll give them back to me. Because these are the only two I have. They're from Dr. Bill Bozanski, and the name of it is The Believer's Right to the Holy Spirit. It's a right you have to receive. You don't want to be, do you ever, I know, back in 1972, there were days that I didn't feel saved. You know, and I say, "Now, Lord, am I really saved?" And then when I received the Holy Spirit, there has never been a day in my life since that time that I have doubted that the Lord had saved me and filled me with His Holy Spirit. And let me tell you another reason why it's important for you to receive the Holy Spirit. And if you never speak in tongues, if you ask, you will receive. Do you understand that? Because some people are so inhibited that they just can't get it through themselves to pray in another language. But I believe if you ask, you will receive. Anybody want to receive tonight? Stand up if you want to receive.
I want to tell you one thing about Daddy. Amen. Daddy, when my mom came, my mom went to Dallas, Texas. And when she was in Dallas, and I know we're a little bit ahead of time, but when she was in Dallas, she prayed. And she said, "Lord," she said, if this is real, I want you to give it to me. I want you to give it to me right now." And when Mama came back from Dallas, she had received the baptism of the Holy Spirit, and she was different. I mean, she was different. Well, Daddy wasn't. No, I'm being serious. And Dad wasn't. He had never received the baptism of the Holy Spirit, and he thought Mom was crazy. I mean, he thought she had really, that she was loose in the head. That, you know, because he'd been taught in the denomination that we were at, that there wasn't but one baptism, and that was water baptism. There wasn't anything else. There was no other way to go. And so when Mom came back and began to tell, I mean, I was little. Dad looked at her like a calf at a new gate. He just didn't believe it. So you want to tell them the rest of the story that you went to Grandma's house?
No, you tell.
Okay. So Daddy said, he said, "Lord," he was at my grandma's house, and I think you were preaching revival up there, and Mama wasn't with him, and he was by himself.
He had Byron with him.
Had Byron with him? Well, that explains why he got the Holy Spirit that night. But he said he was laying into bed at my grandma's house. And my grandma lived in a little teeny tiny trailer right on the side on Highway 90. And he said that he laid there and he just said, "Lord," simply. He said, "Lord, I don't really understand all this. I really don't get it. But Lord, if this is something that you feel like that I need, it's something that I want. And if the baptism in the Holy Spirit will give me the power that I need to carry on my life, then I want you to give it to me, and I want you to give it to me right now. No questions asked." So he said he laid there in that bed, and I remember that bed you were laying in. It was in a little teeny tiny room, probably about as big as a walk-in closet, no bigger. Because Teresa and I stayed there many times with my grandma when we were going back and forth. But Daddy said that It was dark. And where my grandma's, where her house was, the moon would shine right in that back window. But he said that night, he said it looked like somebody had turned a follow spot on and began to shine in his room. And he said the Holy Spirit came upon him in that room that night. And he began to speak in a tongue that he never could imagine. And that night, the Lord baptized him in the Holy Spirit with evidence right then of speaking in tongues. And believed in his heart that it was more. So it's not nothing to be freaked out and spooky about and wonder about. It's not a question of do you want to speak in tongues. The question is, do you want power in your life? Do you want an experience like you've never had before with Christ Jesus? Is it more than salvation? It carries on because he says from glory to glory he's changing me. And his desire is for all of us to walk in the fullness of salvation, the fullness of restoration, and the fullness of the Holy Spirit every day of our life. Because that is what keeps us the power that we need to be overcomers. We can't be overcomers in this day and time without the power of the Holy Spirit.
That's right.
And I'm telling you, that will not happen. So tonight, if you want to receive the baptism of the Holy Spirit, I just want you to stand up. If you want power tonight, you can have it. You can have it.
Greg.
You can have it.
Did you want to say something?
No.
You're just praising the Lord.
So we're going to pray right now. And if there's somebody around those folks that are standing up, you can just walk up to them and lay your hand on them.
Yeah.
Lay your hands on them. We're going to believe right now.
Yes.
Amen?
Yes.
You want to pray, Mom? Jump in it.
Vivian, you want to come join us?
Oh, Lord, we're asking reinforcements to come on up here now.
I tell you something that Ken said at that revival meeting that week. He said that week before he had all of his sermons laid out ready to preach each night, but he said the night after he received the Holy Spirit, he could have preached from the index.
Pray with me.
Listen, all you have to do is ask, you know, and so together let's ask. Let's say, Father.
Father.
I believe in you.
I believe in you.
I believe in Jesus.
I believe in Jesus.
And I believe in the Holy Spirit.
And I believe in the Holy Spirit.
And Lord, your word says.
And Lord, your word says.
That all I have to do is ask.
All I have to do is ask.
And I will receive.
And I will receive.
And Lord, right now.
And Lord, right now.
I am asking you.
I am asking you.
To baptize me.
To baptize me.
In the Holy Spirit.
In the Holy Spirit.
With the evidence of speaking.
With the evidence of speaking.
In another language.
In another language.
And Lord, I expect.
And Lord, I expect.
For this to be done.
For this to be done.
Because your word says.
Because your word says.
In many places.
In many places.
That this is the evidence.
That this is the evidence.
That I will receive.
That I will receive.
When I receive the Holy Spirit.
When I receive the Holy Spirit.
And Lord, right now.
And Lord, right now.
I expect. A river.
A river.
To begin to flow.
To begin to flow.
From within me.
From within me.
And to come through my mouth.
And to come through my mouth.
And from this point on.
And from this point on.
I will not speak in English.
I will not speak in English.
But I will speak in your language.
But I will speak in your language.
And everybody in here that has received the Holy Spirit, begin to speak in your prayer language right now. Speak, lift your hands up and worship the Lord in your prayer language. In your prayer language. Don't be afraid, because it's within the Bible says the spirit of the prophet is subject to the prophet. So if you've received the Holy Spirit, you can pray in another language right now. But I say unto you people, I am the same yesterday, today, and forever. I would never give you a snake if you asked me for something to eat. So you have asked for the Holy Spirit, and I say to you right now that you have received because you have asked. And I ask you to continue to seek me and seek my face, and you will begin to speak fluently in another language.
Speaking tonight, you may speak in the middle of the night tonight.
Now you know it's not that you're weak. He says, I will flow rivers.
Yes, sir. just ask and keep on asking, seek and keep on seeking, and knock and keep on knocking. Just keep on asking. Look, I studied every book I could get my hands on for a solid year before I received the power of the Holy Spirit. And now, if there's anybody that wants to be baptized in water. Okay.
I just wanted to share with you. I remember being 2 or 3. And my mom, being in the car, and she needs it when the car was her prayer time. And I was in the back seat, and I said, Mommy, why did you say each glee, beach glee? And so whenever I was about 9 years old, I was filled with the Holy Spirit. And I've never been afraid of it my whole life. I've never been afraid of the power of the Lord. What I was afraid of was that I was doing it wrong. And I felt like a phony because I didn't know what to say. I wasn't saying each glee, beach glee. And I wasn't saying any language that I had ever heard anyone speak in tongues before. And that is because it is for you. He will give you a special language that's just for you and Him. It's not for anyone else. It's so He can understand you. And I love it whenever I've heard my grandmother say, it's like a police scrambler where it'll scramble your prayers so the enemy cannot hear them. It is an interstate highway communication between you and your Father who's sits at the right hand of God interceding for you at this very moment. So whenever you begin to speak in your prayer language, and don't you dare let the enemy tell you you're a phony or you're faking this or that this is a fake thing because you don't know how to do it. You begin to ask your Father to begin to reveal it to you, and just like a skill that you're honing with Him, allow Him to be your teacher and for you to be His apprentice. And I promise you, if you ask Him, He will give it to you in the name of Jesus. Mima said, there's nothing He would hold from you. Don't you dare let the enemy, when you get home and you're in your car, tell you that you're being crazy or that this is stupid or you're doing it wrong. You with power and speak it boldly in the name of Jesus. If all you get is 2 syllables, you claim those 2 syllables as your prayer language in Jesus' name.
Amen.
Amen. Sorry.
Let me turn on. You got it, Byron? Upon your profession of faith, and because you have asked the Lord Jesus Christ to come into your heart, I baptize you in the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Yeah. Yeah.
Jesus. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord Jesus.
Hallelujah. Praise God. Well, we got one.
Another one?
Yes, sir.
Amen. Come on.
Praise God.
Well, come on, we will hook you up. Woo. Sit down right there. Just sit right there. You love Jesus?
Yes, sir.
You believe in him?
Yes, sir.
You believe that Jesus was raised from the dead
yes,
just
sir.
For you?
Yes, sir.
He shed his blood on Calvary for you?
Yes, sir. Since I was 12.
This is John Parks Thomas. So John, upon your profession of faith, and because you have asked the Lord Jesus Christ to come into your heart, forgive you of your sins, I baptize you in the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit.
Praise God. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Praise God.
Hallelujah. Never forget this night. He said he was sprinkled when he was a kid. And he said, I can't remember that one. He said, but I can remember this one.
Amen. Praise God.
Amen.
Yeah. Anybody else? Well, come on, AG, you're next.
Praise God.
Awesome.
Amen.
Anybody else?
Amen.
Hallelujah. Let's pray. Praise Father, God. We come to you.
Jesus.
Lord, we thank you that what we see is tangible with this water. We thank you that the baptism of the Holy Spirit is just as tangible and just as real. So tonight, Lord, I just ask you for everyone in this place that asked and believe for the baptism of the Holy Spirit, that they can think of it as just as tangible as what this water is. And that, Father, tonight, even before their eyes close and before midnight, Lord, that they would be immersed and covered like never before. And enemy, I bind your tongue in the name of Jesus from ever coming and telling anyone that the baptism of the Holy Spirit is not for them. Because I know what you're trying to do. You're trying to cut off the power. Because you promised us, Lord, that when the Holy Spirit comes, that's when the power comes. So we thank you, Holy Spirit, for coming tonight and doing what you do best. And that's comforting those that are hurting and comforting those that are lost. So we thank you for all of these things. We thank you for the word that has gone forth tonight in the name of Jesus. And we stand on your word in Jesus' name we pray. And everybody say together,
amen. Amen.